minister to you tonight, and again, I want to thank Pastor Mark and Donna for hosting me and giving me the opportunity to minister at this church. And, thank you, Sarah. You get a prophet's reward, right? Not a prophet, but God's used me to prophesy, and I'll be talking a little bit about that as well. Before I get into the Word, I want to give out some things. As an evangelist, I believe my calling is not only to preach the gospel, but also help equip the body of Christ to step out more and be a witness, to share the faith with others. So, Brother Al, could you come up here? I'm going to hand out some gospel tracts. Most of you know these are the tracts that I use when I go out evangelizing. It's called Have You Heard the Good News? And there's a variety of gospel tracts out there. I just prefer to use this one because I know the guy who wrote this. And I'd like to encourage everyone to take at least one track. If you're in the habit already of sharing the gospel consistently, feel free to take another one. I want to encourage you to pray over it. You know, review it first so you know what's in it. And then just ask the Lord to show you, who can I share this with? You know, maybe you know someone that needs the Lord. You can review the track with them and perhaps they'll get saved. Or maybe you might be going through the checkout lane at the store and Lord put on your heart and say, give the track to the cashier. After you pay for your groceries or whatever you're buying, you say, hey, when you take a break, here's some good news you can read. I do that a lot, and most of the time they'll receive the tract, and so it's a way of planting seed, amen? And as soon as Al's finished handing out the tracts, I'm going to give out something else here, too. There's a ministry called the Pocket Testament League. They're based out of Lititz, Pennsylvania, and they make Gospels of John. They put these out in different covers and different translations. And I've been getting Gospels of John from them for a little over 10 years. And it's a blessing because you can order these for free. Now, you can send donations if you want. But since I'm on the front lines, typically what I do is I'll place an order for Gospel of John. Usually in a couple days, someone will sponsor me, and then I'll receive these in the mail. I think you can start off with ordering 25 for free. And so if you go on their website, ptl.org, you can look at the different Gospels of John they have available. Now, some people use these like gospel tracts. They'll just give someone a Gospel of John. You know, that's fine if the Lord needs you to do that. I like to give these to people that don't have a Bible. You'd be surprised when I'm doing street ministry and I'm witnessing to someone. I've even met people that profess to already know the Lord, but they don't have a Bible. It's kind of surprising. And sometimes when I lead someone to the Lord, they don't have a Bible. I'll ask them, do you have a Bible at home? You know, certainly we can read our Bibles on our smartphones and tablets and stuff, but I believe it's good to have a printed Bible because electronic devices, you know, they run out of power, amen? And God forbid, if something happens in this nation where the power grid goes out, say, we have no electricity for a few days. I mean, that can be kind of scary, right? But if you have a strong relationship with the Lord, you're not going to be fearful, but you want to have a printed Bible. I got a printed Bible at home, but I prefer to use electronics because it's faster to look up scriptures. But anyway, I want to put one of these in your hands, the Gospels of John. I got two of these out, two packets of 10. Hopefully you can, oh, you want to help? Thank you. So I'd like to encourage you to take the Gospel of John. You can keep it if you want. I think it's good to have a copy of God's Word on you. Sometimes you might find yourself maybe waiting in line somewhere. That's a good time to read the Word. Or perhaps witness to someone. So we should always be ready in season and out of season, amen? And then one other thing I want to do before I get into the Word, I want to mention I have some CDs with me. Some of them are music projects. I've shared a lot of you before. Before I gave my life to the Lord, I pursued a secular music career. By the time I gave my life to Jesus, I put that aside. But then the Lord eventually released me to start making music again. This is one I put together about 5 years ago called Christmas Chill. Can you believe in about 4 months it's going to be Christmas already? Time's certainly flying, amen. Well, anyway, this is a CD. It's mostly electronic instrumentals of Christ-centered Christmas songs. So if you enjoy Christmas music, I know some people listen to Christmas music throughout the year. But if you like to listen to Christmas music, then maybe it's a little different than your traditional holiday fare. I believe the CD will be a blessing to you. And then I also have some sermon CDs. Pastor Mark used to pastor a church in South Hill, Virginia. A number of years ago, when I was visiting him, staying with him for a season, the motto for his church was, don't do life alone. And one time I asked him if he ever preached a sermon with that title, and to the best of his knowledge, he hadn't. So I thought, well, that would make a good message. It happened to be just before Christmas time. So I put together a sermon called Don't Do Life Alone. And it basically talks about how, as Christians, We can't do life alone. There's a lot of times when I'm out ministering the gospel, I'll meet professing Christians, I'll ask them, where do you go to church? And some of them say, I don't go to church. Or they might say, I used to go to such and such church. You know, and I'm thinking in my mind, why'd you stop going? Some of them might get a little defensive, and they'll say, I have church in my heart, or I have church at home. And certainly you need that personal time with the Lord, but you also need to gather together with other believers. And so again, this is a CD that encourages you to connect with the body somewhere, gather together with other believers on a regular basis. Who would like the CD? You raised your hand first. Do you want to come get it? You're welcome. God bless you. And the rest of you, if you want to purchase a CD, just talk to me after the service. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you again, first of all, that we live in a free country, that we can peaceably assemble. We thank you for the First Amendment that gives us the law, the legal right to gather as believers. We thank you, Lord, we live in a free nation. We thank you, Lord, for our salvation, those of us that already know the Lord. Holy Spirit, I ask that you, I give you permission to submit myself to you. I ask that you help me minister your word with clarity and accuracy. Father, I lift up everyone within the sound of my voice that may be listening or watching online, however this message may be transmitted. Holy Spirit, I ask that you open the eyes of their understanding. I ask you, Lord, to give impartation and revelation to everyone here in this building and those that are listening and watching elsewhere. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all the saints of God said,
amen.
Amen. One other thing I want to ask, if you have a smartphone, I ask that you would silence it or put it on vibrate so we don't have distractions. I'd really appreciate it. Now, if you were here last Sunday, or watched us last Sunday, you recall that Pastor Donna talked about the gifts of the Spirit. And for the sake of time, I'm not going to go over 1 Corinthians chapter 12, but I just want to go over the gifts of the Spirit as a reminder for review. There are 9 of them. There's the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, increased faith, the gifts of healing, the gift of miracles, prophecy, the discernment of spirits, kinds of tongues, and interpretation of tongues. In verse 11 of 1 Corinthians 12, it says, but one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. I mean, these are gifts that you can initiate. These are gifts that will manifest as the Holy Spirit wills. But if you're constantly in tune with the Holy Spirit, then those manifestations are going to happen more often. Now, tonight we're going to talk about another set of gifts in the Bible called the motivational gifts. And these are gifts that all of us have. Whether you're called the fivefold ministry or not, God has given every one of you gifts that he wants to use to be a blessing to others. And these are gifts that you can stir up. In fact, that's the title of my message, Stir Up Your Gifts. We all have gifts. I'm going to review some of the motivational gifts. And I'm going to share a little bit about my background as far as how God has used me in ministry in a variety of ways, and I believe this will be a blessing and encourage you to fulfill the call he has on your life, whether it's in ministry, the marketplace, raising a family, whatever your calling is in life, God wants to use you to be a blessing to the people around you. So if you have a Bible, either in print or electronic, turn to please to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. I'm going to read verses 3 through 8. Now first I'm going to read this from the New King James translation, but then as we go over the gifts, I'm going to look at these primarily from the New Living Translation. I believe it's good to look up scripture in different translations because sometimes you'll see things that you haven't seen before. Amen. So we all found Romans chapter 12? Okay, there, say amen.
Amen.
Okay. Romans 12, starting in verse 3. This is the Apostle Paul writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Verse 6. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Or ministry, let us use it in our ministry. He who teaches in teaching, he who exhorts in exhortation, he who gives with liberality, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness. Now let's review some of these verses, and again, I'm going to mostly read this out of the New Living Translation. Verse 3 in the NLT, it says, "Because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us." Basically, Paul's talking about humility. Certainly, as Christians, we need to be humble, but humility is not putting yourself down. A phrase I hear often from Christians say, "I'm just a sinner saved by grace." Well, scripturally, that's not accurate, because if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then God looks at you as a saint. Doesn't mean you're perfect. We all miss it from time to time. But we need to look at ourselves as saints. We're children of God. We're kings and priests. Amen. In his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, Rick Warren wrote, "Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less." See the difference? I think it was Andrew Murray who stated that humility is knowing who you are in Christ and knowing who you are without Christ. So yes, we need to be humble. Just remind ourselves that in Christ Jesus, we can do all things. But again, it's him working through us. And we need to have confidence. We need to have boldness in who we are in Jesus. Amen. Psalm 139, verse 14 says, "I will praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made." I can think of a couple women I dated that put themselves down. They called themselves ugly. One of them was real beautiful, and when I take a picture of her, it's like she was scared off. You know, it's like God made us in his image, amen? He sees us as beautiful, handsome, regardless of what you look like, amen? All right, verse 4 from Romans 12. "Just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other." Again, you cannot be a successful Christian by yourself. You need to gather together with other believers like we're doing right now. Verse 6, "In his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well." So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. Now, not all of us are called to be prophets, but God can use us to prophesy into other people's lives. But if we're speaking on behalf of God, we want to make sure that we're in tune with the Holy Spirit. And if you're going to give a word to someone and tack on to "thus saith the Lord," you want to make sure it's the Lord, amen? You know, this is something that I'm cautious of, because I don't want to give a word to someone and it shipwrecks their lives, amen? Let me share a couple examples of my life. About 4 years ago, when the COVID lockdowns were happening, I was up in Minnesota. I was staying with a pastor there. And I was going to a lot of home meetings. And there was this one prophet from L.A. who was doing a variety of meetings in the Twin Cities area. And I remember at this one meeting that I was at, there was a woman there. She kind of stood out to me. And this thought kept coming to my mind that God has a mate for her. And I was perceiving God wanted me to tell her that. Well, I was resisting at first. But then I overheard someone said that this woman had loneliness issues. So I thought, okay, this must be the Lord. So after the prophet, who was the main speaker, finished ministering, I walked up to this woman and I asked her, "Have you been believing God for a mate?" And right away there was a woman right by, and she said, "God was showing me the same thing. I should have spoken up." Well, this woman who was dealing with loneliness, she didn't say anything, you know, and I didn't want to scare her off anything, so I just gently told her, "God has a mate for you if it's a desire of your heart." There's also been times when I'm doing street ministry, God sometimes shows me people that are called to preach. That I just don't go right out and say, "Thus saith the Lord, you're called to preach." No, there's nothing wrong with that. I've heard testimonies of people that were hearing callings like that and they were running away from God. But if I'm witnessing to someone and I'm perceiving they have a call to preach, I'll just ask them, "Has anyone ever told you that God's called you to preach?" most of the time they'll say yes, and they'll say, okay, well, Lord, just show me that. That's a confirmation. But there have been a few times when they said, no, I've never heard that before. And so I say, well, I encourage you to pray about it. Maybe God's using me to reveal that to you. Now, as far as receiving words, you want to be a little cautious here. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 20 and 21, in the English Standard Version, it says, do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast what is good. Sometimes we need to receive words from the Lord, quote unquote, with a grain of salt, especially if you don't know the guy that's prophesying to you or the woman that's prophesying to you. I remember one time I was at a meeting in Indiana, and there was this evangelist. He was giving words to people, and he prophesied to me. He mentioned two ministers by name who I happen to know personally, and he told me that I was going to be working with them more in the future. Well, it did bear witness with me because one of them had started teaching things that I thought were unscriptural, and then the other guy had recently unfriended me on Facebook, so I thought, this prophecy's off, you know, so I just basically dismissed it. You know, I'm not calling this guy as a false prophet, but people are not perfect, amen? So if someone gives you a prophetic word, whether it's someone standing in the pulpit or if it's out on the street, if it doesn't bear witness with you, at best, put it on the shelf. And especially if it goes against the word of God, you throw it out, amen? Another time, I was down at Rodney Howard Brown's church. As a lot of you know, I go down to Tampa usually during the winter. When I'm down there, I usually go to Rodney Howard Brown's church. He has a Bible school there called The River. It used to be called River Bible Institute, since changed its name to River University. Well, I remember I was at the church a few years ago. I was attending another meeting there, and there was this Bible school student. I think he was fairly new there. And all of a sudden, he comes up to me and said, the Lord's called you to go to school here. I told him, well, the Lord told me a few years ago, I don't have to go to Bible school. So again, that was, I think he was attempting to step out and give a prophetic word, but he obviously wasn't right. So again, you know, be willing to be used by the Lord to step out and give words, but again, you know, you're handling, you don't want to handle the word of God deceitfully, amen? You want to make sure your motives are right. You don't want to speak prophecies if you're trying to get something from someone, amen? All right, verse 7, it says, if your gift is serving others, serve them well. Now, all of us should have the mindset of a servant, you know, to be a blessing to other people. And again, I'm grateful for Pastor Mark and Donna, who hosted me in their home many times here in the Buffalo area, but also in Southfield, Virginia, a number of years ago. Jesus said in Matthew and in Mark's gospel, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Now, there are some people that excel in serving. They look for opportunities to be a blessing to people. These would be the type of people that would love working as a waiter or waitress in a restaurant, amen? I'm going to pick on you, Al, because you definitely have a servant's heart. When Pastor Mark and I come here around 2:30 to set up the equipment, Al's usually here early. He helps load the equipment off the bus, and he's always asking, hey, you guys want a cup of coffee? I mean, he definitely has a servant's heart, you know. That's a gift that God has given him, you know, to be a servant. You know, we're all called to serve, but, you know, for some people, that's something they like to do more often than perhaps the rest of us. Some of you prepare food. Maybe you'll prepare a dish to bring for us to eat after service. You know, we thank you for that. That's a form of service. You know, that's having a servant's heart. Continuing on in Romans 12, second part of verse 7 says, if you are a teacher, teach well. Now, maybe you're not called to the fivefold office of being a Bible teacher, per se. I guess Joyce Meyer would be an example. But churches need Sunday school teachers, amen? And if you have children, then certainly you want to teach the Word of God to your kids, right? It says in Proverbs 22:6, train up a child the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Verse 8, if your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. Now again, this is something all of us should be doing. You definitely don't want to discourage the brethren, amen? But some of us are more motivated to exhort others on a regular basis. Some translations says to exhort one another. Continuing on, if it is giving, give generously. Now, we're all called to be givers, but again, some excel more in this area. They're the ones that will give the shirt off their backs if you have a need. Maybe you're not called to the mission field, but if you're called to business, God might be calling you to be a generous giver into the gospel, to finance mission trips, like Pastor Mark's upcoming trip to Kenya. I like this quote from Pastor Mark Hankins. He said, if you get addicted to giving, God will support your habit. Last part of verse 8. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Now, in the Amplified Classic Version, the latter part of this verse says this. He who gives aid and superintends with zeal and singleness of mind, he who does acts of mercy with genuine cheerfulness and joyful eagerness. You know, these would be the type of people that might love working in the soup kitchen. Very good. We all have gifts, and a lot of times the gifts that God has given us, it's a desire of our heart. As it says in Psalm 37:4, when we delight ourselves in the Lord, he'll give us the desires of our heart. So once again, for review, the seven motivational gifts are prophecy, serving, teaching, exhortation, giving, leadership, and mercy. Now, there's other gifts in the Bible that kind of relate to this. Some would call it the ministry of helps. And it's mentioned in 1 Corinthians 12. I'm just going to point out a couple parts of this chapter. If you're taking notes, I encourage you to write down these scripture references. Let me go ahead and read this. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, starting at verse 20. It says, but now indeed there are many members, yet one body, and the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on those we bestow greater honor, and our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. It reminded me of a message I heard taught by John Bevere. Have you heard of him, John Bevere? One of his best-selling books is called The Bait of Satan. And I heard him share this in a message one time. He talked about how a lot of times the most valuable parts of the body of Christ are the people you don't see. You know, you might see the well-known evangelists preaching to thousands of people, and yet you have praying grandmas who are just as valuable to the will and plan of God as everyone else, ain't it? And John pointed out that you know, the human body, you know, we think the most important parts are the things we see, like our eyes, our mouth, and yet there are parts of the body we cannot see. He mentioned the liver as an example. And you don't walk up to someone and say, hey, what a nice liver you have. But again, liver is an important part of the body, amen? And so in the body of Christ, there are parts that may not be visible. You don't see these people behind the pulpit, and yet they're just as valuable to God's purposes as those that you see out on the streets and behind the pulpit. Amen?
Amen.
Continuing on to verse 24, 1 Corinthians 12, it says, but our presentable parts have no need, but God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. You see someone get blessed with a new car, don't be jealous. Say, praise the Lord. God can give you one too. Amen. Verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ and members individually. And God has appointed these in the church. First apostles, second prophets, third teachers. After that, miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, administrations, variety of tongues. This is a good acronym for helps. Having enough loving people serving. Can we repeat that? Having enough loving people serving. That's what God needs in the church, amen? Verse 31, it says, but earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I will show you a more excellent way. And that more excellent way is talked about in the next chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. Most of you probably know it's the love chapter. Whatever we do for the Lord, we must have the motive of love. Amen. Love never fails. Turn me, please, to Acts chapter 6. I'm going to point out something else there. I want to point out that how important it is for your gifts to be used in the church. Because again, even if you're not called to the fivefold ministry, even if you're not called to stand up in a pulpit like myself or Pastor Mark or Donna, you're a valuable part to the work of the Lord. Acts chapter 6, starting at verse 1, it says, "Now in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists, because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. Then the 12 summoned the multitudes of the disciples and said, 'It is not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word.'" That's why it's important to have helpers in the church, because pastors, teachers, evangelists, they need extra time studying the word. I heard one minister point out that 1 hour on the pulpit is like 8 hours of manual labor. Because again, it takes time to prepare a message. I spent several hours on this message to make sure what I'm teaching is biblically accurate and it's going to minister to you guys. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Verse 5, it says, "And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, and Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas," I'm probably killing most of these words, "and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch. When they set before the apostles, when they had prayed, they laid hands on them. Then the word of God spread, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were obedient to the faith." So again, God needs all of you, all of us, to use the gifts that he's given us. Now, I can share a little bit about my spiritual background, because God took me through a progression to prepare me for the office that I stand in now. It's the evangelist. I gave my life to the Lord in March 1991, and at the time I started attending a full gospel church called Living Word Christian Center. It's a mega church pastored by Matt Hammond. Some of you may have heard of him. And after I've been attending there for about a few months, Pastor Matt talked about how important it is for church members to serve in the body somewhere. Well, before I gave my life to the Lord, as I said before, I pursued a music career. I had a recording studio, and the church had a tape ministry. And I thought, well, it makes sense for me to help out in the tape ministry, because I already knew how to duplicate tapes. And so I helped out in the tape ministry for a couple of years. And one way it was a blessing to me is I had access to the church's tape library. Now, this is back in the early 90s. You know, we're listening to cassettes. Some of you probably don't even know what I'm talking about. But I had access to the tape library, and so in addition to helping duplicate tapes that we sold to congregation members, I also made tapes for myself. In fact, it was interesting. It was in the early 92, I moved in with 3 other Christian guys, and one of them had just been given this huge box of blank cassette tapes, and he offered them to me. And so I used a lot of those tapes to make copies of sermons from the preachers I preached at Living Word. And for about 4 years, I was listening to tapes constantly. I was working mostly temp jobs, like data entry, clerical, that sort of thing. And a lot of these jobs, they let you listen to tapes while you're working. So I thought this would be a great way for me to feed on the word and make money at the same time. That was basically my Bible school. Well, my involvement with the tape ministry ended in late 93. The Lord had called me to make a temporary move to Chicago. I was there in the Chicago area for about 3.5 months. And then early 94, the Lord led me back to the Twin Cities. And it was a short time later, the Lord was nudging me to get involved with evangelism. That's where I started sharing the gospel consistently on a regular basis. It was in late 1995, I went to a church service with a friend of mine. There was this pastor that was prophesying. I'd never seen or heard this guy before. Obviously, he didn't know who I was. And he gave a rather lengthy prophetic word, and it confirmed several things that the Lord had already showed me. First of all, I talked about the Lord was leading me into a ministry of helps. I was already thinking about becoming an usher. He also stated that I had a call to the fivefold ministry, which I already knew. And this minister also spoke that I don't have to go to Bible school. So getting back to the ministry of helps, it was around that time I had thoughts about becoming an usher. Now, to be honest with you, I wasn't really all that excited about becoming an usher. Back then, the ushers at Living Word wore coats and ties. Nowadays, they wear polo shirts and khaki pants. I've never really been fond of dressing up. I always prefer to dress casual. But I was perceiving the Lord wanted me to be an usher for a season. And so this was getting me outside my comfort zone a little bit, you know, not only dressing up consistently, but, you know, interacting more. It was a way that God was using to get to know more members of the church. And so I was an usher for about a year, and then I felt the Lord said, you know, you're done with that. You know, so then from that point on, I focused on evangelism. I also spent some time working for Billy Graham. If you receive a call to full-time ministry, more than likely you're going to spend time working with another ministry, because you'll learn things when you serve under another minister. You see examples of that in the Bible. Joshua was mentored by Moses. Elisha had Elijah. Timothy had Paul. Now, Billy Graham wasn't really a mentor, because I only met him, talked to him three times. But I spent time working in his film industry, Worldwide Pictures. I was calling pastors around the country, mentioning the latest evangelistic films we had available, and encouraging them to show multi-department outreach event. And so that helped me learn how to interact with pastors of various denominations, you know, encouraging them to do an outreach, you know, become more outreach-minded if they weren't already. Now, I've had some people tell me that I have the quote-unquote gift of evangelism. Now, certainly, the person that stands in the office of evangelist, it's a gift to the body of Christ. But again, I believe all of us are called to be a witness. Now, how do you stir up your gifts? Well, there's a verse in the Epistle of Jude, verse 20. It says, build yourself on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. So if you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence speaking other tongues, I encourage you to pray in the Spirit more on a regular basis if you're maybe not doing that enough. Or whenever you feel kind of oppressed, burdened, start praying in the Spirit. It'll help lift you up. Now, a lot of you probably heard, I think Donna talked about this last week, but there's a difference between praying in the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. When you're praying in the Spirit, you're edifying yourself. And sometimes God will give you the interpretation. Maybe you need to pray about something. You don't know how to put words to it. Start praying in the Spirit. And you can ask God to give you the interpretation. He might give you the words of what you're praying in tongues about. Or you'll just receive a revelation. This is what I want you to do in this situation. So we need to pray in the Spirit to build ourselves up. And again, that's different than the gift of tongues, where you might be in a service like this, someone will give a word, and then someone else will stand up and give the interpretation. You all see the difference in that?
Yes.
Okay, just want to make sure you all know what I'm talking about. Recently, I watched a video by Rick Renner, and he talked about remembering is another way to stir up the gift of God. If you're going through a difficult time, think of previous times God has used you. The Bible says that the gifts of God are without repentance. Maybe you messed up in some area of your life, or you backslid in a certain area. Well, how many of you know we serve a God of second chances, of third chances, fourth chances? We may stumble many times, but as long as we repent, God will help lift ourselves up and get us back on the right track. Amen? So remind yourselves of how God has used you in the past. If you're going through a difficult time, or you think you messed up, so I really blew it this time. No. That's why we have 1 John 1:9 in the Bible. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness.
Amen.
Now, if you're uncertain what your gifts are, I would encourage you to take some time to pray. Ask God to show you, what are my gifts? Or one thing you could do is start writing down what you like doing. What are your interests? What stirs you up? What are you most passionate about? Now, religious folk might tell you that God will call you to do something you don't like. Well, that's garbage. Now, God will often lead you to do things that will get you outside your comfort zone. I mean, like I said, ushering was going outside my comfort zone, and definitely evangelism was going outside my comfort zone. But when I first started stepping out, I started praying with people. Holy Spirit started using me more. It's totally changed my life. So don't be scared if you're perceiving God's leading you to do something you haven't done before, or maybe go beyond your natural abilities. But if you be obedient, you're going to be blessed, amen? Now, Pastor Mark, as a lot of you know, is seeking to have his own building again. Now, when he does, and the church grows, he's going to need help. That might include children and youth leaders, administrators, secretaries, janitors and maintenance workers, transportation workers. I'm sure Mark's not going to want to be driving the bus every Sunday as a church bus. He's going to probably need another bus. He's going to need another driver. Amen. Outreach workers, ushers and greeters, choir members and soloists. Can you imagine us having a choir someday? Musicians, audio and video technicians, website administrators and social media coordinators, treasurers and accountants, kitchen workers, and nursery workers. Any of those interest you at all?
Yes.
Well, when those doors open up, when there's an opportunity to serve in that area, take the initiative, step out, say, hey, Pastor, I'd like to do this for you, if it's okay with you. And if it's God's will, the door will open, you be faithful, and you'll be blessed, amen? And you'll be a blessing to the body as well. Mike Murdoch has said, what you love to do is a clue to your assignment. I know Christians who are passionate about pro-life causes. Now, certainly I'm against abortion, but when I walk by an abortion clinic, I don't feel compelled to hold up protest signs or, you know, trying to stop women from having abortions, since I'm an evangelist. My focus is to get the gospel to people. So again, don't feel condemned or guilty, maybe if you don't have the same passion for a particular cause that another person has. Again, God uses us all differently, amen? Now, the first step in order for God to use you is to make sure that you're in covenant with the Lord, that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Now, I'm pretty sure everybody in this church already knows the Lord, but there's a little test I like to do to verify someone's salvation. It says in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 3, that no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So if you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I'm speaking to those watching online or listening. If you know Jesus as your Lord, on the count of three, I want you to say out loud, Jesus is my Lord. One, two, three.
Jesus is my Lord.
Praise God. As far as I know, everyone here in the house is saved. But in case there might be someone watching or listening, you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, maybe you said that, but if you felt uneasy inside, then I would question your salvation. Because Jesus said that if we don't confess him before man, he's not going to confess us before the Father. Or maybe you knew the Lord at some point, but you backslid. We want to make sure that you get to go to heaven someday. It's by knowing Jesus. Serving in the church does not save you. You must be born again, as Jesus said in John chapter 3, verses 3 and 7. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness or right standing with God, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So for those of you listening and watching, if you know you're not in right standing with the Lord or you're not absolutely sure you're going to heaven, I want to invite you to say this prayer with me in church if you want to pray along and encourage those that need to take the step of faith. Let's say this out loud. Heavenly Father, forgive me my sins. I believe Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose from the dead. Jesus, come in my heart. Make yourself real to me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Keep me away from sin. Give me a passion for the lost. Show me what your gifts are for me. To the best of my ability. And by your grace, I will live my life for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, if you just said a prayer like that for the first time or recommitted your life to the Lord, we want to welcome you to the family of God. The angels in heaven right now are throwing a party for you. That's how much God loves you. He's not mad at you. He's mad about you. Four things I want to encourage you to do. First of all, it's important to pray every day. Pray to the Father in Jesus' name. That's how you get your prayers answered. It's also important to read the Bible every day. The Gospel of John is a good place to start. It's the fourth book in the New Testament. It's also important to get plugged into a good Bible-based church. If you're in the Buffalo, New York area, you might want to check out the table. That's where I'm ministering from. At the time of this recording, they're meeting Sundays at 5 p.m. at the M Hotel near the Galleria Mall. We meet in one of the conference rooms. Come as you are. It's casual. We serve a free dinner afterwards. We have food and fellowship, so we invite you to come check us out unless the Lord leads you to go somewhere else. And last but not least, I want to encourage you to be a soul winner. Even if you're not called to the fivefold gift of an evangelist, again, God wants to use you to share his love with other people. And if you want some helpful tips in that area, I want to encourage you to log on to my website, signsandwonders.org. I write a weekly blog, a monthly newsletter. I also use social media to encourage people to share the gospel. If you're not already friends with me on Facebook and want to connect, look for Todd R. Post. That's the name I go by online. I do have one requirement, though. You have to have a legitimate profile photo. It's called Facebook for a reason. Amen. Praise God. Praise God.